Hello again, everybody, with Steve Stone and Dwayne Stats. This is Harry Carey at Wrigley Field. There have been a couple of ceremonial first pitches tossed. Ron Horn, a representative of Cub Foods, guest of Scott Paper Company, threw out the first one. Also throwing one out, Dick Sturck of Sturck Superfoods, also a guest of Scott Paper Company. Apparently it's a Scott Paper Company day, as Cub sports equipment bags were passed around to all the children today. Here are the lineups for the Reds. Winningham in left, Quiñones at third, Davis in center, Bensinger at first, Rooms in right, Oliver the catcher, Oster at third, Richardson the shortstop, and Scott Scudder, just 21 years old, a right-hander on the mound for the Reds. For the Cubs, Jerome Walton will lead it off. Sandberg at second, Smith in left, Grace at first, Dawson in right, Law at third, Dunson the shortstop, Girardi catching, and Greg Maddux going for his 15th victory of the year. The umpires are Bruce Fleming behind the plate, Terry Tata at first, Dana DeMuth at second, and Steve Ripley at third. The rain has stopped. A few drops are falling now and then, but this game is scheduled for one 1:20 starting time, and we're going to approximate that.
Now you look at how they line up defensively behind Greg Maddux, as Maddux goes to the mound for his 28th start of the year and his third time out against the Reds. This year against Cincinnati, he's 1-0, the ERA 2.12 in his two previous starts. Lifetime against Cincinnati, he's 4-3 with a 4.05 ERA in 8 games. Last time out, he pitched against Houston, and he picked up a no decision, an 8-4 Cub loss, going 6 innings, giving up 8 hits and 4 earned runs. His control has been pretty good, and Bruce Fleming made a quick trip to the mound to see if that drying compound around the pitcher's mound and home plate was suitable for the footing of both Greg Maddux and Joe Girardi. Apparently, they said everything is okay. The game will start on time. It's 68 degrees here in Chicago. The wind is out of the north at 18 miles an hour. It will be a factor because it's going to hold up fly balls. And this is an unusually cool day in Chicago for August.
All right, ready to play baseball. In the fourth, the Giants, with Rick Rushel pitching, lead the Mets, and David Cone 1-0. May that continue. Well, Nolan Ryan, did anybody doubt he'd reach his 5,000 strikeout? He struck out 13 last night, but lost Oakland 2-0, although he gave up only 5 hits. What a performance. Here we go with Winningham. Leading off. First pitch a little bit low.
You have to take the bunt away from Herman Winningham in the right side of the infield, and Grayson Sandberg is back, and that's where Winningham likes to bunt.
That evens a count, a ball, and a strike. Well, I had a pleasant surprise coming up to the booth. I met a guy who I used to broadcast his basketball play, Frank Versalotti of Joliet. He and his wife, Marion, are here along with Bill and Kay Middleton from Joliet. The pitch is high and outside. Frank Versalotti might have been a few days before his time. He's a great basketball player. The pitch. There's a smash headed for center, and Winningham has driven a single to center. Boy, oh boy, these Reds hardly look like the disappointing team they've been. Hardly look like the team that is crippled up with a lot of men out of the lineup. They look like gangbusters against us. That is this week. They look like what they've been in Cincinnati as the Cubs swept them 3 in a row. Here's Quiñones hitting 216, 2-9 in the series. First pitch is high. And Eric Davis is next.
Winningham has stolen 9 bases this year. He's been caught only twice. And Joe Girardi out to the mound to settle down Maddux, who's starting to throw the fastball up in the strike zone, which is not his game.
9 out of 11 for Winningham, stealing bases. Quick throw, the runner back. Birthday greetings from Mrs. Leahy, Jack Leahy's mother. I think her name, her first name is Rose. Jack Leahy being a nephew of the famous Frank Leahy of Notre Dame fame. Jack, a very successful insurance man. His mother's birthday today. Quick throw, the runner back.
Quiñones happy to be at the major league level. One of the reasons why he's here is a tremendous amount of injuries to the Reds this year. He's done a good job and some surprising power from the right side especially.
He's paying an undue amount of attention to Herm Winningham. The guy that can hurt you is right there with that club in his hand. Quiñones. High fastball behind him. Two balls, no strikes. The diehard fans from Kokomo, Indiana are on hand.
The Reds had a terrible July, and that's where the season got away from them. They were just 7-19 in July. And so far, they're 2 over .500 in August as the team is starting to play a little better.
There's another hit, like a bullet in the right field. And Dawson now fumbles the ball, but Winningham had stopped at second base. Boy, I don't care who the hitter is. You keep pitching him 2-0 and 3-1, which the Cub pitchers have been doing of late, and they're all going to be good hitters. And Quiñones hit a bullet in the right field. And now here's a guy you really have to worry about. And thank goodness the wind is blowing in 18 miles an hour.
Surprisingly, when you look at the column of grounding into double plays, you'll see Eric Davis atop the leaderboard. He's grounded into 12 of them this year, and the reason is he's had a lot of leg problems. So perhaps if you get the ball on the ground, you might be able to turn two and help get out of this inning.
Here's the pitch. There, he didn't mean to swing. A check swing out at second base. Whoa, Sean didn't throw to first. I think he had a play. All right. There's a force out. Watch his swing. He tried to check up.
Take a look at Luis Quiñones going into second base. Dunston still got some time. Grace gets him the ball quickly. But he looks at first and then realizes that rather than risk throwing the ball away, he holds it. So the Cubs still with a double play situation.
I think he had a little trouble getting the ball. It seemed like it was caught in the webbing of his glove. Had a little trouble getting it out of his glove. Runners at first and third, and here's Todd Bensinger hitting .247 with 14 homers. He's had a good series, 4 out of 10. Curveball high.
Yesterday he fanned 3 times, and he did it on off-speed pitches and breaking balls. So far, Maddux has been unable to get anything over the plate but a high fastball.
1 ball, no strikes. He had a cut at a breaking ball. The umpires all wanted to be remembered. The Helen McGibney. Want to wish her well. She's in Gottlieb Hospital. And so all the umpires, Fremming and Tata and DeMuth and Ripley, wanted to wish her a quick recovery. There's that play again. 1 ball, 1 strike.
It works well, doesn't it?
Yeah, that really does. The infield back for a double play. A little bit low, ball two.
Bensinger with just average speed, so if you can get a ground ball, you can turn two. And Tony Perez has been working long and hard with Todd Bensinger because he got off to a slow start, and that could be an adjustment to a new league. The fact that he hasn't seen any of these pitchers. Of late, he's starting to swing the bat well.
2 balls and a strike. Fouls it off. The count is 2-2. Kelly Heinz is here with his grandmother and family.
If Maddux can pull the string on Bensinger, he can get him. He's got a good changeup, especially if he keeps it low and away. Let's see if Girardi decides to break one out of the bag. He'll have Bensinger out front. Might be the pitch.
Giants have increased their lead over the Mets 2-0. Rushell against Cohn. Fouled it out of play into the stands on the third base side. Get well wishes of Francis Quigley of Libertyville.
I'd like to wish a happy birthday to Mike Paradise Sr. and a big group here from Las Vegas headed up by Gerald Roth.
Two balls, two strikes. There's a drive foul into the left field corner. And Benzinger can go with the pitch. He hits the ball all over.
He's just tried fastball so far with Benzinger.
Two balls, two strikes. Birthday greetings. Mary Fleming of Streamwood celebrating a birthday. 2-2. Struck him out. Over the inside corner. He gave up on the pitch. And it caught the corner. For out number two, and here is Rolando Room.
Maddux's natural fastball tails back over the plate, and Benzinger thought the ball was inside. The good movement on the ball brought it back over the corner, and Bruce Fremming rang him up.
Ed and Laverne Runnick from Cherry Valley, Illinois. Boy, that's a nice sounding name. Here's Rooms. Curve, strike call. One strike and nothing. Two out, two on. Rooms, a good fastball hitter. One out of six in this series. Homered earlier against the Cubs. Fouls it out of play into the stands on the first base side.
Rooms was 0 for 5 yesterday, and the Cubs did it all exclusively with the breaking ball and the slider.
Oh, and two the count. Davis at first. Winningham at third. A little bit outside.
This was a deal that you want to make. You make a deal that helps both teams. Lloyd McClendon coming to the Cubs. He's put together a good year. And Rolando Rooms, a surprising year for Cincinnati.
Hey! Struck him out. And that ends the inning. No runs, two hits. Two men left. We go to the bottom of the first. No score. Harry Carey back to the ballpark. We're going to the bottom of the first. Lauren Feltus from Carroll Stream, Illinois, celebrating her seventh birthday here today. And the Daryl Lindsay contingent from Colfax, Iowa, also watching the game.
Scott Scudder going to the mound for Cincinnati. He's looking for his first win since June 27th. This is his second go-round at the major league level this year. He was 6-2 at AAA with a fine ERA under 3.
There's a pitch a little bit low to Jerome Walton. Scudder only 21 years old. Big kid, 6'2", good-looking kid.
He's a fastballer with a good arm, but he hasn't shown that he can get the curveball over consistently at the major league level.
Swan, what's the matter with that one?
That was a straight change. And that he does have. He's thrown that pretty well. Last time out against St. Louis, he did get the breaking ball over, going 6 1/3 innings, giving up 5 hits and 3 earned runs. But walks have put him in trouble this year.
The pitch. A little bit low. Well, I tell you, watching him, a 21-year-old kid, with his stuff, I'm impressed. He can really throw the ball hard.
You got to like his arm. The fastball upwards of 90 miles an hour and a number one choice of the Reds in 1986.
Swung and he foul tipped it. Two balls, two strikes. A catcher, Joe Oliver, was hitting a groin, I think, or maybe, oh boy, he's hurt. He's on his knees. The trainer comes out. He might have been hitting the groin. He might have been hitting the... Let's see where. Could have been in the Adam's apple. Boy, there isn't a soul alive who at one time or another hasn't been hit in the Adam's apple, so you know how it hurts. Plenty. Yeah, apparently that's what it was.
That's usually the one spot where a catcher does not have any protection. Now, some catchers have gone to a little piece that hangs from the mask. Joe Oliver doesn't have it. We'll take another look at it. Comes right up off the shin guard and gets him under the mask. He is probably going to be okay, but he's going to remember that for a while.
He's still on his knees, and Scudder just keeps warm by tossing the ball over to Luis Quiñones, the third baseman. A very youthful battery for the Reds. With Scudder and Oliver.
Scudder's another one of those guys from Texas, and they've had a bunch of them make it to the major leagues. In fact, in high school, pitching his team to the state title, he was 19-0 with an 0.99 ERA. But check this out, 205 strikeouts in 120 innings. And Baseball America ranked him the fourth best high school pitcher in the country. And the Reds certainly happy to have him.
Two balls, two strikes. Ball three, low. He's all right. He stays in there. You know, Oliver was just 24 years old. He's out of Memphis, Tennessee. And Scudder's only 21. So they, too, have some youth on their ball club. As do the Cubs. Fouled it again. Attaboy, Jerome. Jerome Walton staying alive, fouling off the good ones, taking the bad ones. You know, that keeps up. Eventually, he's going to walk.
If they're patient with Scudder, they will draw some walks today.
Three balls, two strikes. He did. And Walton gets a base on ball.
With many young pitchers, especially those with good fastballs, they have a tendency to get psyched up in a ball game, try to throw too hard. When that happens, you lose the movement on the fastball and everything stays up. And the one knock against Scudder this year is the fact that he's pitched behind a lot and he has given up a lot of walks. In fact, seven in one ball game.
You remember when you were 21 years old?
I certainly wasn't in the major leagues, I can tell you that.
He is. He is. That's why he might be a little bit wild. But he's a good-looking young pitcher. Throw to first, runner back. Walton, who has swiped 18 bases. Got a good lead. There's a good fastball. Sandberg. Boy, he's been red hot, both in the field and at the bat. He is really having a marvelous year. Hitting 279, 25 homers, 61 RBIs, and never makes an error. Or hardly ever. He hasn't made any for 54 straight games.
His longest streak in 1984 was 61 games, so he's closing in on that mark.
Now ready? High ball. I tell you one thing about trying to steal on Scudder, unless you can get a really good lead, he throws the ball so hard, it gets to the catcher in a hurry. One ball, one strike. No score. He pitched out. Quick throw to first. Runner back.
The Reds had to juggle their pitching rotation. Tim Leary has a bone bruise right in the middle of his pitching hand, and he got it from throwing the split finger fastball. Last time out, he couldn't throw the split finger, and he was roughed up. So they decided to move Mailer back to Friday night in Cincinnati against Pittsburgh and fill in today with Scott Scudder.
Now ready? There he goes! Base hit right field. He's around second on his way to third. Beautifully executed hit and run. And away to go. Runners at first and third. We haven't had one of those for a while.
You certainly haven't seen Sandberg hitting and running, not with the power he's generating, but Don Zimmer breaks one out of the bag, trying to do everything he can to shake up this ball club. And Sandberg with shades of 84, taking the ball behind Jerome Walton, just like he did behind Bobby Dernier.
So our daily double is back again today. And here now is Dwight Smith hitting 296. Six out of 23 against the pitching of the Reds.
He's just two for his last 28, and he's fallen on some hard times.
There's a pitch a little low and inside, ball one.
When a hitter knows that a pitcher can't get the breaking ball over the plate, it makes hitting a little easier. All you have to do is guess location.
Giants 3, Mets nothing. And they're still batting in the fourth. He had a cut, and the count is even. A ball and a strike. It seems like Dwight is pulling off the ball, trying to pull it.
He's forgotten a lot about that butt up the right side, which gets you a run in this situation and moves a man to second base.
Now the pitch instead over to first. The Mettingers are here from Algonquin, Illinois. Curve in there, strike call. Boy, that would have been a great pitch to bunt. A curve. Infield playing back.
By Dwight's own admission, he's thinking some about the long ball. He's hit 7 home runs this year, but that really isn't his game. His game is hit the ball hard to left center field.
Struck him out. And Smith goes down swinging. Seen it happen so often.
Good straight change by Scott Scudder. So he showed Dwight Smith that he can get the straight change and the curveball over the plate. But that's the first curveball he's thrown for a strike.
Here now is Mark Grace. He's leading the, he's tied for the team lead in RBIs with 61. Over the first, runner back. Grace with 12 home runs. Infield back for the double play. Swung and he missed. Change of pace curveball.
Mark Grace has only fanned 28 times this year in 391 at bats, and he needs some contact here.
Grace fourth in the league in hitting. Gwynn out in front. That evens it up. Birthday greetings to Dan Peacock, watching the ball game here with his family from Crystal Lake, Illinois.
On a fly ball, Eric Davis has a great arm in center field, and Rolando Rooms a pretty good arm in right. Winningham, the weakest of the throwing outfielders.
Scudder backs off the rubber. He was going to bunt. Now he's in the hole, 1-2. Well, I don't see anything wrong with Scudder's curveball. 21 years old. Boy, he's a good-looking pitcher. One ball, two strikes. High inside. The Laverne Helms in Denver, Colorado. Three generations of them are watching the ball game here.
Well, you wonder if Don Zimmer is going to send Ryan Sandberg, who swiped 13 bases, try to stay out of the double play in a ground ball.
Two balls, two strikes. Runners first and third, that's what they had in their first and didn't score. There he goes, swung and fouled back. The shortstop was breaking over the cover. The Gephardts are here from Peoria. And boy, Pete Von Anken and the Peoria Chiefs have won 8 in a row as of last night. They're doing well down there. Two balls, two strikes. There goes the runner. Slammed to the shortstop. The run will score. Boy, he almost got a bad break, Grace. He hit the ball hard. The shortstop was going over to cover the bag. He had a stop, but he fielded the ball, which might have gone by him otherwise. and got the force out. Cubs lead 1-0.
Ball is hit too hard for Ron Oster to get to second base, and because of the movement, and the Cubs have tried two hit and runs this inning, they've got a run. So Don Zimmer a little more aggressive today, and it translates into a 1-0 Cub lead. RBI 62 for Mark Grace.
So Sandberg is on at second. A run is in, and here's Dawson. Dawson hitting 246. He's 2 out of 7 in the series. There's young 21-year-old Scott Scudder. 24-year-old Joe Meyer behind the plate. Joe Oliver, behind the plate. 4-0 Giants. Giants out in front, 4-0, still batting in the fourth in New York. Montreal plays later tonight against the Dodgers. All outside. Vance Law will be next.
Wouldn't be surprised if Andre Dawson has given the 3-0 go in this situation. Got to figure to get a fastball. Scudder, wanting no part of Dawson so far, hasn't been close.
Another youngster here, Mark Vassallo, celebrating his 11th birthday. Ball four, he walked him. And here's Vance Law, runners at first and second.
Tommy Helms managing the ball club in the absence of Pete Rose, who's back in Cincinnati after the birth of his new daughter. And here comes Scott Breeden to have a word with his youngster, settle him down. He's fallen into the pattern that we've seen so much of a youngster. A little anxious, getting behind and walking some guys early.
The gang is here from Munster, Indiana. And Rich Wold from Corvallis, Oregon.
We'd like to send along get well wishes to Bob Dvorak, recuperating in LaGrange Community Hospital. Bruce Fleming out there now to break up the conference in the mound. Nobody warming up in the bullpen, so he's just trying to settle him down.
All right, here's Law. He's 2 out of 5 in this series. He homered yesterday. He's batting 239, and over the year, he has hit well against the Reds pitching staff. 18 out of 44. Runners first and second. A cool day in Chicago. Swung and he missed. The Mets are batting in the bottom of the fifth, trailing the Giants 4-0. Come on, Big Daddy. That's Rick Reschel pitching for the Giants.
And he's looking for number 15. You know, Dave Cone is 8-0 this year in New York.
There's a hit. Here comes Sandberg. He's heading for the plate. He'll make it. 2-0 in favor of the Cubs. Vance Law hit a solid single to left, scoring Sandberg.
RBI number 38 for Vance Law, and he gets the job done. And the bases on balls have come back to haunt Scott Scudder. Fastball, inner portion of the plate. Law rips it to left field, and no chance to get Sandberg.
Dunson is on a hitting rampage. He's raised his average to 279. For the first month of the season, he was under 200. Here's Dunston. Runners first and second. Fastball over the outside corner. The Durhams from Lindenhurst pulling for a Cub victory. Base hit! Great stop by the shortstop. Saved a run. Holy cow. Great play by Jeff Richardson. The shortometer goes up to 281, and it's still rising.
What an effort by Jeff Richardson. He's only playing because Barry Larkin is hurt. Mariano Duncan has some hamstring problems, so the youngster pressed into service, and he saves a run right there.
So the bases are loaded now for Joe Girardi out of Peoria. Fastball low. Girardi's 0 for 5 in the series. A left-hander getting ready.
Tim Bertzis.
Boy, he's a big man. He fouled it back. It's one ball, one strike.
And that was off Bruce Fleming, and that'll shake you up.
You can't hurt Bruce. He's a wonderful little guy. One ball, one strike. They list Bertzis at 6'7". Boy, he looks about 7 feet tall.
Joe Girardi giving Bruce Fleming some time to get composed. That'll make some friends, and if you're a catcher where you need some pitches, umpires appreciate that.
Flattery will get you nothing in baseball. You know that. One ball, one strike. He swings and he misses. Two strikes and the ball. The bases are loaded. The Cubs are out in front, 2-0. At the end of five, the Giants lead the Mets 4-0. Ground ball, too short, cut off by Quiñones. Gets a force play to retire the side. Two runs on three hits. At the end of one, the Cubs are out in front, 2-0. Harry Carey and Steve Stone and Digger Phelps up here in the booth. All right, tell me all about your basketball team.
Well, I think we're going to be pretty good. We got everybody back. We had no seniors last year, and playing a lot of road games just to toughen them up. I thought we played well in the first and second round. We lost to Georgetown and Providence, but I think the Irish are going to be exciting.
We're going to miss you on Channel 9. I'm sorry we don't have your games, but the best of luck anyhow.
Yeah, how you been? You guys are doing a great job this year. I think Stone's influence on the entire pitching staff has been, if we can find that fourth pitcher right now, huh?
Well, I think Steve Stone's influence on Jamie Meyer is probably the reason Jamie came up with a sore arm. How is he, by the way?
He's hanging in there. He's still in rehab down in Texas, and I think by September he may get a start again. But he's missed since early June all the way up to now. But he's a tough kid. He'll get it done. By the way, you still guys owe me for the wedding.
Nice to see you, Digger.
Good to see you. Take care.
Say hello to Lou Holtz and the gang. Two strikes and nothing on Joe Oliver, the catcher. 24 years old. Scott Sutter, 21. They got youth, as do the Cubs. Greg Maddux, only 23, and he's a veteran. Scudder's only a rookie, but Maddux, an established veteran, who's still learning his trade. Two balls, two strikes. The Mets are losing 4-0 at the end of five. There's a smash. Fielded beautifully. Safe on a close play. Boy, oh boy. Sandberg made a remarkable play and almost had him in first base.
Dunston flashes across and can't come up with it, but Rhino's right behind him. And he tries a bouncing toss to first. That's about all he can get on the ball. And almost gets Oliver, but he beats it by an eyelash. The call by Terry Tata.
All right, and Oliver's on. He's been a good hitter. That's 4 out of 7 in this series. As you can tell, here's a pitch a little bit low. Sandberg's errorless streak isn't because he doesn't have to cover much ground. He roams far to his right, far to his left. He gets balls nobody else would reach. And he almost turned a remarkable play there. One ball, one strike. Nobody out. Ron Oster hitting 222.
Oster, a switch hitter, but he doesn't play much when he faces left-hand pitchers, hitting just 152 from the right side, but 240 from the left side.
There's a bouncing ball. Grace has it. Safe, a wide throw. Both men are safe.
And Dunston
and
looks like he's
Dunston
hurt.
Is hurt.
It's going to be an error on Mark Grace. For only the fifth time this year, Grace is charged with an error.
Boy, much more important the error is the condition of Dunston. He might have twisted his knee trying to catch the wide throw and still step on the bag.
When he realized that he was being pulled off the bag, he pivoted quickly to try to put the tag on Oliver, who runs fairly well for a catcher. We'll take another look at it, and Grace throws this ball on the third base side, pulling Dunston off the bag, and right here, when he goes to make the tag, that's when he comes up lame. Looks like he's going to be okay, yeah. And that's a sigh of relief to everyone.
Both men are safe, and Jeff Richardson, the young shortstop. It might have been on the tumble, on the somersault, that he hurt his shoulder. Well, anyway, he's staying in the ballgame, so he's okay, and that's the important thing. Now, Grace's wide throw gives him a break. Cubs leading 2-0. And Jeff Richardson, 3 out of 10 in the series.
That's the fifth error in the series for the Cubs, who made 3 yesterday.
Here's Law pulling in, expecting the bunt. I don't know that I expect a bunt here with the pitcher coming up next. I hope Richardson doesn't bounce one by him. Unless Scudder.
1 for 12.
He doesn't look like he would be a good hitter.
Richardson's been a decent hitter this series and a decent hitter against the Cubs, despite the fact that he's hitting just 167 overall.
Scudder's 1 out of 12 has fanned 7 out of the 12 times. One ball, no strikes. He's going to hit. I thought he would. One ball, one strike. Richardson hitting only 167.
Cubs haven't given him much of anything but fastballs to swing at, and more times than not, he's hit the ball hard to right and right center field.
Richardson, 24 years old. The delivery, curveball, strike call. One ball, two strikes, nobody out. The pitcher Scudder will probably come up to bunt. Law drops back in normal position. 1-2 the count. Oliver a lead off second. Oster off first. One ball, two strikes.
This is a big situation for Maddux, because the Cubs in a streak where just about every mistake they've made over the last couple of weeks has really come back to haunt them. Another mistake here, and let's see if Maddux can pitch through it.
A little wide, two balls, two strikes. Maddux had to work out of a situation in the first. First two men hit safely. He got the next three. Nobody out here in the second. The sun trying to peep out from behind the cloud. The pitch, bouncing ball over the first in time. Law throws out Richardson, but the runners advance to second and third.
Scudder's got 2 sacrifices this year, and in the back of your mind, you have to be concerned about the suicide or safety squeeze. Infield is going to pull in at the corners. And a meeting with Dave Bristol, the third base coach. Lee May, the first base coach for the Reds. Bristol having a word with his youngster.
There's another youngster, Roman Angelo Robles, celebrating his 8th birthday. He's from Plymouth, Indiana. And Michael Pomisano and his daughter Laura are here from Dayton.
5 wild pitches this year for Greg Maddux. And Girardi went out to tell him, in a stretch, if you see the runner going and I've called a breaking ball, throw that high, tight fastball and back the pitcher out of there.
Strike call. Herm Winningham is next. Tough left-hand hitter. The infield in. Scudder digging in. He had a cut and he missed it. 0-2 the count. Scudder out of Paris, Texas. One ball, two strikes. The Mets are batting the bottom of the 6th, trailing the Giants 4-0. One ball, two strikes. He struck him out. The ball gets away. He throws the first base of the out. The other runs have to hold on. Maddux was where he should be, right over home plate.
Good heads-up play by Greg Maddux. And Joe Girardi takes some time to take a look at third base. He realizes that Oliver's not going anywhere, and then he makes that good throw to first.
2 men are out. Here's Winningham. He singled his first time up. 3 out of 9 in the series against the Cubs.
Winningham, originally a member of the New York Mets, later went on to Montreal in the Gary Carter deal, and now a member of the Cincinnati Reds.
Hey, Digger, have you been on the diet? I think you look a little lighter, too. Here's a pitch. Strike call. Oh, and one. 2 out, 2 on. The outfield bunches them towards center. A little bit inside. Winningham. He was originally with the Mets. Oliver, the runner at third. Oster at second. The sun trying to peep out from behind the clouds. One ball, one strike. Inside, ball two. Luis Quiñones. The third baseman is next.
Winningham came up with the Mets in a tough situation because he's a natural center fielder, and they had Len Dykstra and Mookie Wilson, so there was a log jam there already. They found him expendable, and a good farm system allows you to trade people.
Ball three. 3 balls and a strike. In the top of the second. You know he's geared up for the fastball, Winningham. But the fastball was outside. And that fills the bases for Quiñones, who's been hitting the ball pretty well. 3 out of 10 in the series. 5 out of 21 for the year against the Cubs. 8 homers, 17 runs batted in. But the wind is blowing in out of the north at 18 miles an hour. The pitch. Strike call.
Quiñones getting a chance at third base because Chris Sabo has a knee problem, and he will probably be lost to the club for the year.
1 strike to nothing. The Reds have the bases loaded, two out. Cubs lead 2-0. Strike call. 0-2. The first one hit the outside corner. This one, a high, tight fastball over the inside portion of the plate. 0-2 the count. Big pitch. Fouled it back. He was checking his swing. 0-2. Boy, it'd be nice to make an error and get through the inning without anybody scoring for a change. 0-2. Hey, struck him out. And the inning is over without a run. Quiñones goes down swinging. Three men are left on base. We're going to bottom of the second. Cubs leading 2-0. Harry Carey back at the ballpark. Cubs are number one on Channel 9. All right. Arnie's favorite line, getting to be a habit watching the Cubs. We go into the bottom of the second. Here's Maddux, who's pitched five innings already. We're only in the bottom of the second. He had a pitch over here. The first two men hitting safely in the first. Finally got out of that. Then an error put him in trouble in the second. Finally got out of that. He has 13 hits for the year.
The Reds have left five men on base the first two innings, and you wonder how that will bode for Maddux as the game goes along.
There's a strike call. One ball, two strikes. At the end of six, the Giants lead the Mets 4-0. Struck him out. A breaking ball on the outside corner. That'll bring up Jerome Walton, who started it off with a walk. Digger, this kid has been sensational.
You know, he's really kept his composure, and he's just got a lot of confidence going right now. And that's so important for a young player to come in and just make that contribution to what success the Cubs have had this year.
Here's a pitch a little bit outside. He's a well-disciplined hitter. He knows his strike zone. He hits the ball all over. He's tremendously fast, has a fine arm. There's a drive in the right field, gonna be caught. Rooms under it, and he has it. The wind now, the ball sounded well hit. The wind is blowing in about 18 miles an hour. Look at the flag.
You're going to have to hit a line drive to get one out of here today, but Sandberg is one of the guys, along with Dawson, who could probably do it.
Two out, nobody on. Pitch a little high. John and Andy from Kansas City are here.
Even with the off day tomorrow, Don Zimmer has decided to use a fourth starter. He's not going to skip over the fourth starter, giving his pitchers another day of rest.
Elizabeth and Jay Craig are here from Evansville, Indiana. Sandberg takes it outside. Ball three. Dwight Smith will be next. Three and nothing. Right in there, a strike call. The kid has a little card, MVP, All-Star. And it's printed on the back just like the regular stars. Ball four, he walked him. But it's a picture of this little boy. He's 12 years old, Justin Clark Hart of the St. Joseph Little League. He's 4 feet 11. He weighs 98 pounds. He's with the Texas Tigers. He plays first base. His favorite pro is Ryne Sandberg. There goes the runner. Swung on a drive left field. May drop. Did he catch the ball? A wonderful play.
And he's hurt.
Winningham, and he is hurt. The wind was carrying that ball. He came across the line, backhanded it. He might have bumped into the fence. He's still lying on his face. That will retire the side. And now all the red players. Watch it again.
Would have been a sure run for the Cubs with Sandberg running on the play, and he does bounce right into the padding.
His face hit that ball right under the padding. I will be back now at the end of two innings. He's getting up. We'll be back at the end of two innings. The score remains Cubs 2, Reds nothing. Herm Winningham is all right. He's staying in the ballgame. Here's Eric Davis to lead it off. Here's another look now. This ball, only a guy with Winningham's speed would ever have caught it. Now watch where he hits the wall. Boom, right there. One strike on Eric Davis. Hitting a force play. A fortuitous development in the first inning. Giants still leading. Mets batting bottom of the seventh. 4-0.
Maddux could use a 1-2-3 inning and try to save on the pitches.
A bouncing ball. Sandberg to his left. He is up.
There's got to be communication between a first and second baseman. The first baseman has got to know just how far his second baseman can range. In the case of Sandberg, that's pretty much from bag to bag. There was no doubt that Mark Grace realized Sandberg was going to be there. He just goes back to the bag and makes the play.
One out, nobody on. Todd Bensinger's the hitter. Bill Merchant, president of the Red Cloud Club, with his daughter Susan, helping us celebrate her birthday here today. There's a line drive base hit. Benzinger singles the left center. I'm glad he didn't do that in the first inning. One on, one out. That's a fourth hit for the Reds.
Rolando Rooms was languishing at the AAA level, and then Eric Davis had some leg problems, so he got an opportunity to come up, play center field, and he's been here ever since.
One strike and nothing.
Most of the people rating the rookies this year, Liss Walton number one, Dwight Smith number two, and Rolando Rooms number three.
All former Cubs or present Cubs. Boy, he had a good cut that time. 0-2. I hope they don't forget to curve him. This guy hits a fastball a country mile. He fouls it back and out of play.
He's thrown three straight fastballs to him. And the first time up, he struck him out on a tight fastball. But now if you sweep that slider away from him, Rolando Rooms has a habit of swinging at most everything, especially a breaking ball down. All Girardi's got to do is block it if he goes that way.
There's a slider outside. One ball, two strikes. One out, one on, 2-0 in favor of the Cubs. Trying to check his swing, he fouls the pitch back down the right field line.
To this point, Murray Cook has avoided making wholesale changes in his ball club because he's had so many people injured. He wants to get guys back healthy again before he makes some deals. He traded away Cal Daniels. They needed a pitcher. They got Tim Leary and Mariano Duncan in that deal with the Dodgers.
Bouncing ball foul. Craig Lefferts has relief for the Giants. They plan to use Rick Rushel only six innings today, and he shut the Mets out for the six innings he was scheduled to pitch. Wrigley Field's a sellout. Even the birds having trouble finding a seat. One ball, two strikes. Hey, struck him out on a wide breaking slider. That's the second time the Rooms has gone down swinging.
If you can stay away from Rooms, you don't have to throw a strike. Maddux sweeps that slider well outside. It started outside and continued out that way, and Rooms missed it by a foot.
That's a fourth strike, fifth strikeout for Maddux. Ooh. He fouls it off his foot, I guess.
Oliver's having a tough day. First he gets hit in the throat, and then he fouls one off his foot.
Did you say deep throat?
No.
Oh, and one to count. Two out. Joe Oliver singled his first time up. Hey, swings and he misses.
Redsfield there in pretty good shape behind the plate. Jeff Reed is hitting the ball well. He's hit over 300 the last month. And Joe Oliver just coming of age. So perhaps they will allow Bo Diaz to test the free agent market. He's got a big contract and a history of injuries.
Wide breaking curve. One ball, two strikes, two out. We're in the third. 2-0 Cubs. Cubs trying to break a five-game losing streak.
They've got a good man on the mound to do it in Maddux, although he's thrown a lot of pitches through three innings so far.
We're not through the third. We've been playing for over an hour already.
Game's moving right along.
The pitch. Hey, struck him out. We go to the bottom of the third. The Cubs hold their lead at 2-0. Harry Carey back at the ballpark. We go now into the bottom of the third. Mark Grace will lead it off. The Giants in the top of the eighth still lead the Mets 4-0. The first pitch to Mark Grace. A little bit low. Bob Peer and his family here from Decatur, Illinois. That's my friend Bob Skeffington town, the Budweiser man down there. Two balls, no strikes. That guy looked like Buddy Ryan, the coach of the Philadelphia Eagles, former Bear defensive coach. Two balls and the strike. There's a drive, but it will be caught. Eric Davis is there. Grace hit the ball right on the nose, but out. Here's Andre Dawson.
Eric Davis covers as much ground as anybody else, despite the fact that he's had the leg problems. He can go get him to either alley. Generally, when you hit it to center field, go back to the bench.
We want to send along our good wishes to Cecily Weber. From Chicago. Here's a pitch high. The Moose Lodge are here from South Bend. Fouled it out of play. One ball, one strike. One ball, one strike. Breaking ball outside. Gene and Arnold Swanson, relatives of Spike Odell. They're here from the Quad City area. Jake Odell, an uncle, is watching the game in Tucson.
The Reds think they've got enough pitching next year. If Scudder throws the ball like he's been throwing it, Leary comes back healthy along with Jose Rio, Rick Mailer, Tom Browning, and Danny Jackson, they've got some pitching to deal.
Three balls, two strikes, and a lot of ifs that they need the answers to. Danny Jackson was a great pitcher last year. He's out for the year. 3-2. Rio likewise. Ball four. And Andre Dawson walked. That's a fourth walk given up by Scudder.
Might be another good opportunity for Don Zimmer to break out the hit and run that he used so successfully in the first inning. You've got a man up in Vance Law who's bounded into 9 double plays this year.
Pop foul out of play. Boy, oh boy, I still looking at the headline. Nolan Ryan, the pitch he struck out Ricky Henderson on for his 5,000th strikeout was a fastball clocked at 96 miles per hour.
That was the hardest fastball he was to go on to throw all game when he struck out 13 in that one.
Struck out 13. He gave only 5 hits, only 1 earned run, and lost 2-0.
That's been the story of a great part of his career here. Right. He strikes out a lot of guys, and it seems that his team doesn't score him a lot of runs. That's the reason he's only 25, 26 games over 500. But a sure Hall of Famer.
One ball, one strike. There goes the runner. Swung and missed. The peck. He is safe. A stolen base. Andre Dawson steals his 6th base of the year.
The hit and run was on, but Vance Law can't make contact in the high tight fastball. Oliver takes some time to deliver the ball, and fortunately for the Cubs, he throws it on the third base side of second. Now Richardson makes a tag, but the swipe tag doesn't get Dawson. And applaud Dana DeMuth. The ball beats Dawson, but his leg is in before the tag. You can see it right there.
One ball, two strikes. Vance Law, the hitter, drove in a run. High. Two balls, two strikes. Law drove in his 38th run in the first inning.
Willie Mays, the only man in baseball history to have 300 home runs, 300 stolen bases, and over 2,000 hits. And Andre Dawson, 18 stolen bases away from that coveted mark.
There's a pitch foul. Two balls, two strikes. You know, Bob Welsh was a winner for Oakland last night. Nobody even knows he pitched. The attention was all Nolan Ryan, naturally. He struck him out. Here's Dunston.
Wouldn't be surprised if they pitched Dunston very carefully in this situation. Tommy Helms knows he's been a red-hot hitter. You've got Girardi due up next. Already down 2 runs, and Dunston's been hitting everything in sight.
They are going to walk him. Puts it up to Joe Girardi. An intentional pass to Sean Dunston.
This is showing a lot of...
He's been getting a lot of those, especially lately.
14th intentional walk this year. You can understand it as an 8th hitter, which is where Dunston spent a great portion of this season. But now that he's hitting in the 7th spot, this is just plain old respect.
So Girardi will be the batter. Runners at first and second. 2-0. In favor of the Cubs. Giants now lead 5-0. Ground ball, that'll end the inning. Girardi on the first pitch bounces into a force play. Dwayne will be coming along in a moment. This is Harry Carey from Wrigley Field, where at the end of three, the Cubs lead 2-0.
Ron Oster bounces the first pitch foul, and the fourth inning is underway at Wrigley Field. With Steve Stone and our producer-director, Artie Harris, this is Dwayne Stats. Cubs are out in front 2-0 as they try to break this losing streak, and Maddux is throwing the ball hard today.
And an oddity in this one. Combined, both teams have left 12 men, so both pitchers having the pitches pile up, and Maddux has thrown about six innings already in three.
Oster with a count of 1-1. 1-2 now. Six strikeouts for Maddux through three innings. He's walked one, allowed four hits. Oster reached on the throwing error by Grace his first time and is out on strikes this time. Ron Oster caught looking.
The fastball of Maddux tails away from the left-hander, which is good if you're throwing the ball outside. But he's left a lot of the left-handers standing there because the ball looked like it's going to be inside. At the last instant, it drifts back out over the plate. And Maddux getting a lot of mileage on his fastball today.
Jeff Richardson, the shortstop, bounces this one foul. Richardson out third to first his first time. Well, we're seeing some patches of blue sky. The tarp was on the infield all throughout the pregame. We did have some rain here prior to the contest, but we do have a little blue sky peeking through now. The count to Richardson is 1-1.
All things considered, a beautiful day to pitch. Any pitcher who doesn't like the wind blowing in at 18 miles an hour in this ballpark probably doesn't like to pitch too much.
Two balls and a strike to count. The Cub outfield around the other way with Richardson up there. Smith, Walton, and Dawson in the outfield. That squares the count at 2-2. Not only do we have fans inside the park, we have them out of the park as well.
They gonna count that on the attendance?
And this one is down. We put that shot up just to set you up. We were waiting. 3-2 the count on Jeff Richardson. Maddux looking for his 15th win. Into the stands goes that foul chop.
Career high in strikeouts for Greg Maddux was 10 coming into this year. He can strike you out, but doesn't usually pile them up. However, today an exception with 7 already, and we're only one out into the fourth inning.
And he walks Richardson. He had 8 the last time he pitched against the Reds. He had a no decision in that 5-2 12 inning victory for the Cubs at Cincinnati on the 15th. He struck out 8 and walked 2. He struck out 7 and walked 2 today. And here's the pitcher, Scott Scudder, who is a strikeout victim in the second inning.
High fastball might get a pop up. Scudder has 2 sacrifices this year.
He bunts this one up the first base side. He's out, and down to second goes Richardson. 3 unassisted on the sacrifice. Richardson in scoring position with 2 gone for the top of the batting order. There's Richardson at second, and Herm Winningham, who took quite a spill an inning ago and stayed in the ballgame. Boy, when he went down, you had envisions of all kinds of terrible things happening with that knee. He slipped on the wet grass in left field.
It was a great catch because it saved a run. Sandberg running on the play and Dwight Smith going down the left field line with the wind taking the ball away from him. He stayed with it all the way. Took a dive and really collided with the under part of the wall very hard.
Willingham fouls this one straight back. Well, you could see that right knee when he slipped go out from under him. An easy way to certainly hyperextend a knee or strain something. And of course, the more drastic stretch or tear something.
I think he was pretty happy that this was a natural surface because he might not have had a whole lot of skin left if it was the artificial turf.
Two strikes the count. Cubs scored both their runs in the first. The Reds have left six men on base, including the bases loaded in the second inning. They stranded two in their first, another one in the third, and they have Jeff Richardson in scoring position at second in the fourth. A ball, two strikes. Let's take another look at that catch by Willingham. Watch his right leg go out from under him right there. And he went sliding into that wall. And he appeared to be down for the count at that point. Two balls, two strikes.
Maddux trying once again to go inside with the tailing fastball. He had Willingham jumping out of there, but the ball just a shade inside. And fortunately, the umbrella's out for the sun now and not the rain.
A full count. Quiñones is on deck. Luis Quiñones. The Giants in the eighth inning in New York have a 5-0 lead. Lefferts on in relief of Rushel. Foul ball. Matt Williams hit a home run of that game for the Giants. And Greg Jeffries left after six innings with back spasms. So a full count on Herm Willingham. And another foul ball. Cubs got some help and remain a game and a half in front of the New York Mets. The Giants shutting out New York 5-0 last night.
And the great story in that one is Bob Nepper wasn't supposed to pitch, but Don Robinson had an elbow problem, and a recycled Bob Nepper, who was a free agent when the Giants picked him up, came out and threw a shutout. Not bad in New York to shut out the Mets.
3-2 again. Willingham bounces this one once more. Foul. It's three up that way. So the standings right now, the Cubs leading by a game and a half over New York. The Expos two back. St. Louis running fourth. The Cardinals are just three games back. They've won three in a row in seven of their last 10. So you can't lose sight of the St. Louis ball club. 3-2 again. And a chopper up the middle, and that's going to slip through for a base hit. Here comes Richardson in to score. Willingham chops a single through the middle. That's his ninth run batted in. And it's a 2-1 ball game. Richardson, who walked, scores on the base hit by Willingham, and Don Zimmer strides to the mound.
It's only a matter of time when you keep giving up a lot of base runners before the opposition finally breaks through. Zim going out to talk with Maddux with the pitches piling up. Base on balls coming back to really hurt Maddux here. He had scrambled out of the first three innings. But this time the Reds get a run, and the Cubs now have just a one-run lead.
El Quiñones will be the hitter. Maddux struck him out with the bases loaded in the second inning. Now Quiñones up with a man at first and two outs, a run home in the fourth, as Bruce Fremming goes out to break up the conversation. Here's the RBI single.
This ball not hit hard, but hit in a good spot. Sandberg can't get to it. So now you've got a good base runner at first in Herman Willingham, who swiped nine bases this year. And this is a running situation for the Reds with the left-hand hitter up. Maddux will have to keep a close eye on him.
The off-speed pitch, Quiñones out in front, strike one. Maddux against Scudder in the final game of the series with the Reds. That's a looper into right center, falling in for a base hit. Winningham's on his way to third. The throw cut off by Dunston, first and third now. And Eric Davis is going to be the hitter. That's what you fear. Winningham chopped the single into center. Quiñones keeps it going, and now the Cubs will have to face Davis.
Maddux is forgetting all about his breaking ball and straight change. And when he's got hurt today, he's gotten hurt on the fastball. He continues to throw them a steady diet of fastballs. Nobody up in the bullpen. The most devastating hitter on the Reds due up.
Davis, 0 for 2. His average, 275. Fourth in the league in home runs, 27. Fourth in the league in runs batted in, 77. He takes ball one. The Cubs have now been out hit 6-3, cling to a 2-1 lead. Ground ball, he got in on him. Dunston with the flip to Sandberg for the force, and that retires the side. One run, couple hits, two left. Bottom of the fourth coming, 2-1 Cubs. Greg Maddux leading off the fourth inning for the Cubs. With that foul ball, the count goes to 1-1. Maddux called out on strikes in the second inning, facing right-hander Scott Scudder. Scudder has struck out 3 and walked 5. Maddux with a tap. Scudder gets the tag on him. Scudder's pretty much the typical story of a young pitcher with a good arm. Good fastball. He has a good changeup, but the Reds are hoping that he can improve the breaking ball and improve his location.
You saw by the graphic just put up there, 14 men left on base between these two teams, so both teams with ample opportunity to score. Scudder has walked 5 men so far, but the Cubs, who got 3 hits in the first inning, haven't been able to get another one off Scudder.
Here's Walton, who walked to open the Cub first and scored a run. He's out in front, strike one, flying to right his last time. Top of the ninth, that's Shea, 5-0 Giants. This one down, a ball and a strike. So the Cubs again today, seemingly getting some help from San Francisco. The Cubs leading in this one 2-1. Strike on the inside corner. One ball, two strikes.
Scudder does not tip off his changeup. He's got good arm motion on it. That's why it's an effective pitch. And more times than not today, he's kept it down.
Low outside. 2-2. You saw Walton shorten up. Even with two strikes, he's such a good bunter that that's not completely out of the question for him. 2-2 the count. Now we go all the way to 3-2. One out, base is empty. Sandberg is on deck. Wind blowing in today at Wrigley Field. Ball four upstairs. That's the sixth walk. Scudder had walked more than he had struck out coming into this game in 57 and a third innings. 36 strikeouts and 38 bases on balls. And that tendency is holding true today. The Cubs have had some opportunities and now have Walton aboard.
They tried to hit and run in this same situation in the first inning, and it worked to perfection with Sandberg taking an outside fastball and going to right field.
Sandberg with a base hit and a walk. Walton draws the throw. Ryan has had a great month of August. Drives this one deep to center. Back goes Davis on the track, and the wind keeps it in the ballpark as Davis hauls it in. On another day, that ball had a chance to go, but not today. With the wind blowing in, it's a fly ball to the warning track for the second out of the inning.
That one hit as hard as you'll see a ball hit. Unfortunately, Rhino didn't pull it. It was a line drive. Davis had just enough room. Now keep your eye on Walton. Here's a running situation for the Cubs. Let's see if Zim takes advantage of it.
Dwight Smith, nothing out of two. Start of the day at 296. Walton back in. Jerome with 18 steals. He's been caught six times on the year. He's 1-0 against the Reds running. Scudder keeping an eye on him. Dwight Smith now 4 of his last 35. Fly ball center field. Davis makes the grab. Cubs are out in the fourth, a walk and a man left. So we've gone through four and the Cubs lead 2-1. From Wrigley Field, fifth inning coming up. A one-run ball game, 2-1. They've been runners all over the bases. The Cubs have stranded seven. The Reds have stranded eight. We're through four and onto the fifth with Todd Benzinger leading off. Benzinger, one out of two. He fouls this one, strike one. We were talking the other day, Steve, about all the good players who've come out of the Cincinnati area, and here's another one just down the road from Cincinnati, Todd Benzinger. So the deal that found him in a Cincinnati Reds uniform moving over from Boston in a sense brought him home. Two strikes the count.
Another player on Cincinnati who's lost to the team, who probably will be back, however, in a few days, is Paul O'Neill, and he's from just down the road in Columbus, Ohio. They can use another left-handed bat in this lineup, and O'Neill was putting together a great year.
Benzinger out on strikes to start the fifth, and that's eight strikeouts for Maddux.
Some of Buick's finest are with us today from Buick's Chicago zone office, including Al Andrea of Grant Dean Buick.
Here's Rolando Rooms. Rooms bunts, third base side, barehanded pickup and throw, and it's a wild throw down near the bullpen, but backed up by Sandberg. That's a bunt single for Rooms. Rooms was having problems making contact against Maddux and decides to try to bunt his way on and is successful here in the fifth.
This shows you what happens when you've got good speed and you can lay down a good bunt. Law makes a fine pickup, but throws the ball on the inside of the bag. No chance for Mark Grace. And fortunately, this ball doesn't get away any farther. Rooms cannot advance, but it goes as another Cincinnati hit.
Well, it makes a lot of sense for Rooms. He had struck out all three times he faced Maddux over in Cincinnati, and twice today. So he decides to try to bunt his way on. And here's Joe Oliver lifting a pop fly near the line and right. The wind carries it away from Dawson, and he cannot catch up to it. A foul ball, strike one. So Oliver is still alive on what started out as something of a routine pop fly. The wind got hold of it, carried it away from Andre Dawson.
Maddux will have to keep his eye on Rooms, who's stolen 10 bases this year. Rolando's been caught six times.
One strike the count. And this one is inside. Oliver checked in time. Oliver's had a rough day. Took a foul ball off the throat, fouled the ball off his foot. Reached on an infield hit in the second inning, struck out in the third. Drives this one deep down the left side. Smith back looking up, and that's gone. Well, that home run for Oliver, his second of the year. And the Reds are out in front, 3-2. A line shot out to left, and the Reds have taken the lead I'll tell you, Oliver's had a tough time getting into the lineup because Jeff Reed has been doing such a good job catching and hitting. And Oliver, who's been banged around a little bit today, did not want to get out of that lineup. Stays in and hits the home run here in the fifth inning.
Maddux got a sinker up. And Oliver hit it out of the ballpark the way you have to today. The 10th home run Maddux has given up, and that was a line drive.
Here's Oster, strike one. The Reds are not altogether surprised by Oliver's fine play. They think he's got a chance to catch a lot for them in his career. Short left center, and Smith makes a diving attempt but comes up short. Walton there to pick it up, and Oster with a big turn holds it first, looping a single just out of the reach of a diving Dwight Smith.
The wind helping out the Reds on this play. Dwight Smith coming on with a fine effort but comes up a little short on the dive. And Maddux has given up three hits in a row. No activity in the pen. Don Zimmer does not want to go to that beleaguered pen. Cubs have used nine pitchers in this series. Smith has the ball hit right off his glove.
Now Richardson takes a strike. Richardson walked and scored in the fourth inning. There's the Cub bullpen. Richardson, you can see there, hitting only 164. Fouls this one back. 0-2. Richardson had a couple hits here on Monday, including an RBI single and a three-run seventh. That turned out to be a big hit. Loops this one foul. The Reds have now hit 10 home runs off Cubs pitching. That's the first one Maddux has given up to Cincinnati.
That one fouled off in a section of Reds fans. Everybody wearing red hats and red shirts. And the Wrigley Field faithful giving them a resounding boo for their efforts.
Maddux misses a ball, two strikes. There they are. And a Wrigley Field souvenir to boot. Ground ball, Dunston. He'll step on the bag, go over to first, and that takes care of the Reds in the fifth. Richardson grounds into the double play. They score two on three hits. We go into the Cub half the frame. 3-2 Cincinnati. Mark Grace opens the Cub fifth, and Scudder misses too low, ball one. Final score, the Giants have beaten the Mets 5-0. Rick Rushel wins his 15th. He is 15-5. David Cone, the loser, 11-6. Fly ball into left. Whittingham will have to go back near the track, on the track for this one. Grace made a bid to the opposite field, but it's tough. Oliver hit his more on a line, and this was a fly ball, and with the wind blowing in, it was blowing in at 18 miles per hour when the game started, so it's tough to get anything out that way.
Let's watch the inning-ending double play again as Sean Dunston decides to take it himself, and for that inning-ending double play, Carex helps with the brakes on cancer with a $50 contribution to Cubs Care.
Dawson has walked twice. Two of the six walks given up by Scott Scudder. He continues to stay away from Andre, missing ball one.
You don't want to get in a situation where you're a run or two behind in the late innings with Rob Dibble and John Franco in that bullpen. That is the Reds' strength.
That's wide. You know, it's an interesting thing about the Reds, and Franco said it himself. He said he wouldn't be surprised if he might be included in a trade by this Cincinnati ball club because of the emergence of Dibble. And when you look at their entire pitching staff, when they get everybody back, there's a strike call. Not only would they have, at least in Franco's mind, the possibility of trading a stopper out of the bullpen, but they're going to be pretty deep in starting pitching as well. There's ball three.
there's been a lot of setup men that have grown into the role of a stopper, and the way Dibble is throwing the ball this year at almost 13 strikeouts per nine innings, you'd say to yourself you could feel comfortable with him coming in to nail down the ball game. And Franco, one of the best short relievers in the game.
Andre takes it up the right side, but foul. And we go to 3-2.
When you look around most clubs, you wonder where the trades are going to come. I mean, who are you going to give up to get what you need in return? The Reds have the one thing that everybody needs, and that's a few guys who can throw the ball. The big ifs are Rio and Jackson. Will they come back to be the pitchers they were last season?
The 3-2, and Andre just a piece of that one to stay alive, and Oliver took a shot off that foul ball. So Oliver, despite the fact that the good has been the two-run home run, continues to take a beating in this game.
Not a big enough beating as far as the Cubs are concerned, because he's the man who's done the damage so far.
Andre pops it short center. The wind carries it toward right center, and now Rooms comes on. It's another one of those that the wind took care of. Eric Davis started in. Oster broke toward left center and then had to circle back, and it was Rooms who made the grab. Same thing happened on a ball hit by Walton back in the second inning. Davis started in on the ball, and the wind carried it to Rooms. Two gone. Here's Vance Law. Vance has a run batted in with a base hit. One for two, and there's ball one. Vance had a couple hits in yesterday's game. That's a good pitch by Scudder, and the count is 1-1.
Bruce Fremming gives you a very consistent strike zone behind the plate. And there's the standings up to date at this point. Montreal, New York, St. Louis, only two back in the loss column.
There's a foul ball straight back. So you don't want to overlook that St. Louis ball club.
You know, looking at the line score last night, Whitey Herzog continues to do it. And he does it with mirrors out of the bullpen, showing a pitcher for a third of an inning or two thirds of an inning after Ted Power left the ball game. He went to three pitchers. None of them pitched an inning, and he nailed down the victory.
Oh, takes it high, 2-2. And you're right about Fremming. He gives you as consistent a ball and strike call as you're going to see.
And what you want, Dwayne, is a second inning strike to look exactly the same as an eighth or ninth inning strike. And you can bet that Bruce is going to be right there.
2-2 the count. This one starts to shallow center. Davis cuts to his left and in, makes the catch, and the Cubs are out of the fifth. We are through five, 3-2 Cincinnati. Scott Scudder, the Cincinnati pitcher, leading off the sixth. The count's a ball and a strike. Scudder, Winningham, and Quinones. Maddux misses upstairs. 2-1. Again, San Francisco has beaten New York at Shea. 5-0 the final. A strike is called, and the count goes to 2-2.
21 years old and showing a lot of poise, the man you're looking at, Scott Scudder.
This one looped foul.
He had a tough first when he couldn't get the ball down, but after that, he's held the Cubs at bay. They don't have a base hit since the first inning when they picked up three hits and two runs.
And Maddux goes all the way out on Scudder, 3-2. Scudder came in with a 2-5 record and an earned run mark of 455, making his 10th start. And he draws a walk to start the sixth. Well, that's about the last thing Maddux wanted to do, issue a leadoff walk to the pitcher, Scudder. That'll bring up Herm Winningham. Winningham has been on base three times, two singles and a walk. He drove in a run with a base hit in the fourth.
The pitch is piling up. Don Zimmer getting the bullpen loose.
Whittingham lofts a popper left side. Dunston after this one, foul ball, and he's got it. Well, Maddux gets Whittingham on the first pitch. That's a lift after walking the leadoff man. Here's Quiñones.
Les Lancaster getting loose in the bullpen.
Quiñones, two out of three. A single in the first and a single in the fourth. Takes a strike. Quiñones playing in the absence of Chris Sabo. Luis was playing in Nashville, hit 229 there. Pops it up. Another pop up. This time Law gets the call and makes the catch. So Whittingham and Quiñones pop out. Scudder at first with two quick outs following the leadoff walk. And Eric Davis is the hitter. Davis 0-for-3. But always dangerous. Drives this one to right field. Dawson all the way back and against the wall. Dawson
is hurt. The ball drops
out there. I think the ball came back and got him. Scudder scores. They're holding Davis at third as the throw comes back in. It's a triple for Davis, and Andre is down. I think the ball maybe came back and got him, and he is hurt at the base of the wall in right field. So a triple for Eric Davis to make it 4-2, and Andre in the vines is hurting out there in right.
Walton did a good job going over and getting that ball, as you saw it just at the last instant trickle away from Andre Dawson. Looks like he might have hit his head against the wall. Watch it again. Davis, even into the wind, is strong enough to hit this ball against the vines. Looks like Andre's going to make the play. He gets back to the ivy. Now watch what happens. Apparently the ball must have caught him right in the back of the head.
Yep. I think that's what happened, and you see the ball right next to his right foot. The second triple of the year for Eric Davis. Dave Bristow had the stop sign up, and Davis was thinking about an inside the park home run. Here's another angle, Steve, and see if we can see the ball.
Well, he takes a pretty good shot there. He doesn't realize he's as close to the wall as possible. And now the ball just trickles behind him, and it's just the force of Andre hitting that wall that shook him up. Strange occurrences here today. And you'll see the ball come trickling down right behind Andre.
There it is. Andre with full force backing into that wall, and the ball down there as well. He is up now. Trying to reorient himself out there. John Fierro and Don Zimmer along with Andre. And Andre is going to stay in the ball game. He took a good shot right back into the wall. One more look.
We saw Herman Whittingham go into the wall down the left field line. He came out unscathed, if not shaken up a little. But Andre Dawson, the same thing. Fortunately for the Cubs, he's going to stay in the game. Dunston's been down today. And here comes the baseball. Trickling out as Andre actually blocked it against the wall with his body.
So the Reds score another run. It's now 4-2. Dawson's all right. The 78th run batted in for Eric Davis. It is Todd Benzinger. Benzinger takes a strike. To see Davis almost run through Dave Bristow down at third base. Reminded me, Bristow's coached third base a long time as well as managed in the major leagues. And this pitch hits Benzinger. That'll put runners at first and third. That's the fifth man Maddux has hit this year as Lancaster continues to throw in the bullpen. Bristol says he can remember only two runners deliberately running through stop signs of him at third. One was Mike Schmidt and the other is Pete Rose, who's now his boss as the Reds manager. Here's Rooms. Strike one.
Not necessarily a bad pitch to Benzinger to put him on, because he's had such good luck with Rolando Rooms over the past couple of games.
One for three today with a bunt single. Otherwise, he's had problems making contact. Fouls this one. Two quick strikes. Scudder has scored after leading off the inning, drawing the walk.
Maddux is due up third in the sixth, so Don Zimmer will most likely go to the bench. That would bring Les Lancaster into the game as the Cubs trying to break out of this five-game losing streak.
There's a ball. The frustrating thing about the performance so far for Maddux, he's walked three men, and two of them have turned out to cost him runs. He walked the number eight hitter Richardson, who scored in the fourth, and the pitcher Scudder here in the sixth inning, and it's cost him another run. The count is even now to Rooms, 2-2. The Reds have four runs, 10 hits. Benzinger breaks, the pitch is inside, the throw is in time. Sandberg takes the peg and Benzinger cut down to retire the side. One run, one hit, one left. Bottom of the sixth coming. 4-2 Cincinnati. Bottom of the sixth coming with Steve Stone and our producer director Artie Harris. Dwayne Stats from Wrigley Field. Well, it's turned out to be a beautiful day here, despite all the rain early and the threat of more rain. The only problem from the Cub perspective now is that they're down 4-2, and the Reds have a couple big arms in that bullpen.
And there's the man you certainly don't want to see, Rob Dibble, getting loose. Elms has got a lot of mileage out of Scudder today.
Dunston takes a strike.
Greg Maddux almost caught that throw to second base. He didn't realize that Girardi was going through on the steal with Eric Davis at third. He cut down Benzinger for the sixth time this year, and a great throw.
A swing and a miss. 0-2 the count here to Sean to start the bottom of the sixth inning. Girardi catching in the place of Berryhill, who's nursing that tender right shoulder. Joe's been throwing the ball extremely well. One ball, two strikes. Let's take a look and watch the throw by Girardi go right over Maddux.
Look at Maddux. He's jumping up to get it. He doesn't realize that you got to throw through with a guy that doesn't run very well.
This one wide. 2-2. Maddux, you saw him first go down. And then he went up and tried to catch the ball. A spring straight up. Dunston into right field, and Rooms makes the catch. He wasn't sure for a moment. A little stutter step out there, but made the grab. Two runs, three hits for the Cubs, all of that in the first inning. Scudder has struck out three and walked six. The only base runners the Cubs have had since the first came on walks. Here's Joe Girardi. Mitch Webster has moved into the on-deck circle for the Cubs. And Girardi takes a strike.
There's a lot of scouts at every game this time of year, and the stock of Joe Girardi rising with every throw. He is a well thought of young catcher.
One and one to count. Giants have beaten the Mets at Shea, 5-0. Ball two, 2-1. So at the moment, the Cub lead stands at two. Following this game, it will be either 1.5 in front of the Mets or 2.5. Foul ball out of play, so the count goes to 2-2. Of course, right now, they're two games in front of New York. and also two in front of Montreal. St. Louis three back. The Expos are home tonight against the Dodgers. And the Cardinals are on the road in Atlanta. Girardi strikes out. Four strikeouts for Scudder, two gone in the Cubs' sixth. And Mitch Webster will pinch hit. So that's it for Maddux. Maddux gives up 10 hits, four runs, including a home run, hit a man, struck out eight, walked three in six innings. And here's Mitch Webster.
Hitting 256, two for 19 with three RBIs as a pinch hitter.
He goes after the first one and lifts it foul, strike one. Brett and Brooke Lewis have brought their parents to the game today, hoping to see the Cubs snap out of this five-game losing streak. They've had a tough time with Scudder since the first. 1-1 the count on Webster. This is the longest losing streak for the Cubs since their seven-game streak back in June. Strike call. It's now one ball, two strikes. High foul. It's drifting out of play. We're talking about trimming an inning or so ago. Baseball America has conducted a poll of managers throughout baseball, different position players, different arms, who has the best arm. And of all those umpires listed, the best umpire consistently turns out to be Bruce Fremming. There's two balls, two strikes.
Well, there's no doubt he's consistent behind the plate, but he gives you the good effort every day. Just a quality professional umpire.
Another foul ball. He's intense. I'll tell you, his first pro year umpiring, he ejected an entire press box, and earlier this year ejected a couple fans out of the dugout box seats at Dodger Stadium. Chopper to the right side, and that's taken by Benzinger. Unassisted, and the Cubs are out in the sixth. Harry will be back in a moment. Through 6-4-2 Cincinnati.
Hello again, everybody. With Steve Stone and Dwayne Statz, Harry Carey back at Wrigley Field as we go now into the top of the seventh. The ball game, 4-2 in favor of the Reds. Here's Rolando Runes, the right fielder.
Les Lancaster on the mound, 3-1, 0.96 ERA. Lancaster on for the 25th time.
There's a pitch driven into right field. The wind carrying it, carrying it, carrying it. And it's a fair ball. And here comes Rooms around second, on his way to third. Everything is happening to the Cubs on windblown fly ball. And Rooms winds up with a triple.
This is not played very well by Andre Dawson. He realizes the wind's going to take the ball away from him. Now he's coasting. Instead of running to the spot, he coasts over there. He just doesn't make the play.
A triple for Rooms, so Lancaster immediately is in trouble. They call it a triple. The infield in. Here's Joe Oliver, who hit that tremendous home run against the wind. His last time up, which put the Cincinnati Reds ahead. 24-year-old catcher. And boy, he shows some promise.
This man hit just 205 last year at the AAA level. But he's a big, strong man.
Now the pitch. Fouled it out of play. Hey, Robin Earl used to play for the Chicago Bears. Now in the insurance business. Here with his family watching the game. Has a company of his own, Robin D. Earl and Associates in Northbrook.
Rob Dibble loosening up in the bullpen.
The infield in, the pitch a little bit inside. Lancaster. The count, one ball, two strikes. Infield in. Base hit, right field. The run is in. Boy, oh boy. Oliver singled to right. Scoring runs.
Three RBIs for Oliver. 14 for the year, and he's 3-for-4 today. He's been a one-man gang for the Reds offensively. High fastball out of the strike zone, but up there you get a good look at it, and Rolando Rooms scores easily.
The Cincinnati fans who are here are enjoying this. It is now 5-2 in favor of the Reds. Here's Ron Oster. Swung and he missed. You know, Scott Scudder, the 21-year-old right-hander, was touched for two runs on three hits in the first inning and hasn't allowed a hit since.
Steve Wilson getting loose in the pen in a hurry.
Pitch a little bit inside, one ball, one strike. Ooh, boy, will things be tight after this one. Unless the Cubs can rally. There will only be the difference of one on the lost side between four teams. There's a pitch foul. The Mets, Montreal, and St. Louis all have lost 57. The Cubs will have lost 56 if they don't win this one. A great chance to gain ground on the Mets, but they're trailing here. Two balls, two strikes.
There you take a look at the standings up to date, including the Mets' loss today to San Francisco.
The throw to first, the runner back. Boy, those Cardinals without any attention are right in the middle of it. Ground ball. Sandberg over to second for one, over to first. Out, a double play. From Sandberg to Dunston to Grace. And Dunston's the only shortstop who could have had a double play on that ball, which is not hit hard.
Oliver stops running. He doesn't want to run into the tag, but Sandberg doesn't pay any attention to him, makes the good flip to Dunston coming across, and he fires to first to get him. Terry Tatum making the call at first base. It's very close, but they do indeed complete the double play.
Here now is Jeff Richardson. He drew a walk in the fourth, which led to a run. Rooms beat out a bunt, which led to two runs. Here's a pitch foul out of play in the fifth. With one out, Rooms beat out a perfect bunt, and Joe Oliver homered to put the Reds ahead. One ball, one strike. Fouled it back. One ball, two strikes, two men out. The Red fans are sitting upstairs here, and they're getting booed. The pitch. He struck him out. One run, two hits. Nobody left. We're going to the bottom of the seventh. 5-2 Cincinnati.
Some runs, but first, a one, a two, a three. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out to the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I ever get back. Oh, it's root, root, root for the Cubs. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it. The old ball game. Hey, let's get some runs.
We're going to the bottom of the seventh. We want to wish goodwill to Ralph Jack at Hinsdale Hospital. A quick recovery, a former member of the WGN crew. Here is Jerome Walton, and look who's pitching out there. Ron Dibble, who's pitched 11 shutout innings, allowing two hits in his last eight relief appearances. Good. Bullet strike call.
He's 7-3 this year. The ERA 2.12. You wonder who scores off him. On for the 59th time with a couple of saves. 113 strikeouts and 76 in the third inning.
Hit by Jerome. He lines that ball hard in the right field. Walton lines a single to right. That brings up Sandberg, who's one out of two.
Great outing for Scott Scudder. He gave up the two runs in the first inning, and that was it. Going six innings, giving up just three hits, walking six, one intentionally, and fanning four.
5-2, the Reds are out in front. Here's Sandberg. He was robbed by the wind of a home run in the fourth. But Oliver hit the ball so hard on the line, the wind could not affect it. For the Reds in the fifth. Walton, a runner at first.
Fans here trying to get behind the Cubs, making some noise, hoping the Cubs can come back against a tough right-hander.
Rob Dibble. Swung and he missed.
Everybody talks about the fastball of Dibble, and well, they should. It's 96, 97 miles an hour. But that slider that he throws is close to unhittable when he keeps it low and away to the right-hand hitter.
Dibble, spelled backwards, comes out Elbid. Elbid. There's a foul ball out of play. Well, right frontwards or backwards, he can sure throw the ball. 0-2 on Sandberg now. Dwight Smith will be next. Fouled it again into the upper deck down the right field line. Walton single to start this inning was the first hit the Cubs have had since the first inning. Struck him out, a slider over the outside corner. Another strikeout for Dibble.
Rhino thought it was up. It buckled his knees and snapped over the plate. It's another slider, and Dibble's got a dandy. Not much doubt about that.
He now has fanned 114 and 76 and two-thirds inning. Here's Dwight Smith taking it high and outside. He's averaged 13.3 strikeouts per nine innings. A lead by Walton. High foul ball out of play. The count has evened up, a ball and a strike. Smith has fallen into a slump. One ball, one strike. Fastball outside, ball two. The Cubs need three.
Tom Browning went the distance yesterday, but the Cubs saw Dibble in the night game on Monday. Pitched two innings, struck out five men.
Strike call over the outside corner. It looks like Dwight is looking for a pitch he can pull. And that's been the case during his slump instead of just hitting the ball as he did previously to all field. Two balls, two strikes. A little low, ball three. Boy, he becomes important now because it would bring the tying run up at the plate if he gets on there. 3-2. There goes a runner. Struck him out. Stolen base. Smith goes down swinging.
Walton steals 19th. Bullet-like fastball. No chance for Dwight Smith. And a good jump by Walton.
So here's Grace. He just swung right through the ball. So Walton is on in scoring position now. And here's Mark Graves. Strike over the outside corner. Boy, between his fastball and his slider, that's all he really needs. A little wide, that evens it up. Dibble is fan two. 115 now for the year. He started a swing, tried to check. Boy, he's only pitched 77 innings and has 115 strikeouts. To the plate. He's out at the plate. Holy cow. A great throw by Whittingham. On a line single to left by Grace. Jerome Walton thrown out at the plate. Damn the inning. No runs, two hits, no error. At the end of seven, it's still the Reds 5, the Cubs 2. Harry Carey back in the ballpark on the first pitch. Bruce Fremming, as Dibble swung and hit a foul ball, he's really hurt, squirming in pain. Bruce Fremming, let's watch it again.
You can see where Bruce sets up, and this ball gets him. Looks like right in the side.
Ooh.
Right next to the chest protector, and the chest protector probably didn't even get a piece of that ball. It's right on the ribs, and oh, Bruce is in a lot of pain.
Watch him, the way his body rolled over. He's still in pain. The umpires all around him, so is Don Zimmer, the trainers, both clubs. It looked like he might have been hit just to the left side in the chest below the heart. Only one other game in the major leagues was played today. The Giants shut out the Mets 5-0. Watch the play again on the foul tip by Dibble. Just on the left side. Seems like he got it in his abdomen. Boy, he rolled over in pain. And he's still down.
We've seen a lot of them down today. Whittingham in left field. Dunston at shortstop. Andre Dawson collided with the wall in right field. And now Bruce Fremming.
You know, all of a sudden, the Cubs, who, as everybody knows and has referred and made passing reference too many times, there's Bruce. Let's see if he's going to Dave Brissell, the third base coach of the Reds. John Fierro, the Cub trainer. Bruce is in a sitting position now. You know, in this period of six games, all the good breaks the Cubs were getting all year long seemed to completely turn around.
Every decision made by both Chuck Cotter at third base, Don Zimmer, and a lot of the base runners have gone against the Cubs. That was a gamble that Chuck Cotter took on the base hit by Grace. You're three runs down with Dawson coming to bat. Winningham was playing shallow in left field. Took a pinpoint throw to get him, but that's exactly what happened. Winningham made a great throw. They cut down Walton at the plate, and the Cubs were out of the inning. And fortunately, Bruce is up in some pain, but he's up and around, and that is pretty good news. He's a nice fella.
But watch Walton being thrown out of the plate to end the seventh inning. Here's a hit by Grace to left. I see he was playing shallow. He has the ball when Walton is rounding third base.
It takes that great throw to get him, but you're still three runs down. Oliver blocking off the plate, puts the tag on him, and that took the Cubs out of the inning.
Well, Bruce Freeman is going to stay in the ballgame. Here's another shot of that. Close play, but he was out. According to the only man that counts, the umpire who makes the decision. And the replays like that have proven they're right about 95% of the time. Dibble takes a curve low. Dibble. He hasn't had a hit this year. 0 for 5. He's won 7. He's lost 3. He's saved 2. There's a high pop foul out of play.
Facially, it looks like a king-size Ray Knight. As you look at the men left on base, most of those left on base early in the ballgame when both teams had a lot of chances.
Another foul ball. One ball, two strikes. Joe Oliver's home run turned this game around. Nobody thought anybody could hit one out today with the wind blowing in at 18 miles an hour. But he showed you how it could be done as he hit a line drive into the left field stand. Now the count to Dibble. 3-2.
It was the leadoff walk to Scott Scudder in the sixth inning that produced a red run.
Three balls, two strikes. Fouled it back. Well, it looks like 15 victories is tough to achieve. Sutcliffe failed at it. Maddux has failed at it a couple of times. Bielecki had a chance. There's a hit. Line drive's going to be caught. Dwight Smith makes the catch. One out. We're in the eighth, looking ahead to the Cub eighth. It'll be Dawson leading off. Law and Dunston. Boy, that Dibble is a big horse, ain't he?
Six, four, 235.
Gabby Street probably watching the game upstairs in the Valhalla Sports used to say, too big to be a man and not quite big enough to be a horse. Two balls, no strikes. One out. A nice save, but he can't make the play, drops the ball. A fine stop by Mark Grace, who, as he started to throw from a kneeling position, dropped the ball. See what they're going to call it.
Winningham's been on base 4 times today. This looks like it should be a base hit. although Grace could have made the play if he comes up with it, which he does. He turns around but has the ball trickle away. I got to figure it's a base hit, and that's what it's going to be judged.
One out, one on. Here's Quiñones, 3 out of 4 for Herman Winningham. Curve in there, strike call. A little bit inside. 1 ball, 1 strike. Quiñones is 2 out of 4 today. There's a blooper in the short left, another hit. And that gives him 3 out of 5. Well, he reached outside, I think, for this pitch. Let's see the replay.
The ball's well out of the strike zone. Lancaster trying to go away. Just off the ground, probably a foot outside, and that shows you how things have been going. Everything the Reds hit winds up finding a hole, and the Cubs cannot come up with a big hit when they need it.
This is the same team that the Cubs last week swept in Cincinnati. And the Reds now are trying to return the compliment. Runners on at first and second with one out. Eric Davis. Fastball inside. There's a curve in there, a strike call.
14 hits today for the Reds. Ironically, all the runs have been scored from the fifth hitter on down. Although the top four have done a lot of damage, none of them have scored a run yet.
1 ball, 1 strike. There's a fastball for a strike call. Eric Davis is credited with a triple and RBI in the sixth. He now has driven in 78 runs. Struck him out. Davis is called out on strike. Two gone. That'll bring up Todd Benzinger. 1 out of 3 for the day. You know, Maddux struck out 8 today. Lancaster has 2, that's 10. There's a pitch foul back. In a losing game yesterday, the Cub pitchers struck out 12 or 11 Red players, and they're 7-2 defeat yesterday. Benzinger with a ball and a strike, switch hitter. 1 out of 3 today. Slow curve outside. Two balls and the strike. Ball 3. Boy, the acquisition of Ted Powers has really helped the Cardinals. And Bob Nepper came along and pitched a shutout for the Giants against the Mets last night. And the Giants shut him out again today. There's a drive. Center field. Going to be caught. Jerome Walton to retire the side. 2 hits, 2 men left. We go in the bottom of the 8th. The Reds are leading 5-2. There's Dawson leading off the eighth. Slider inside. Hey, V.D. Himsdell at Northwestern Memorial Hospital. Want to wish him a quick recovery. There's a drive and a left field, a base hit. So Dawson leads off the eighth with a single to left. Boy, oh boy, that'll look good in the seventh inning, wouldn't it?
This copyrighted telecast is presented by the authority of the Chicago National League Ball Club, which has the right of approval of the announcers and is intended solely for the private non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or the use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Chicago National League Ball Club is prohibited.
Here's Ernst Law. Pitch outside. Hey, there are people here from Naples, Florida. They're sitting on the bleachers today. Quick throw, runner back. Over 33,000 paid here today. The Cubs closing in on the 2 million mark. Strike call. Pete Carrillo and his father here from Sacramento. Two balls and a strike. Inside, ball three.
Dibble struggling today. He's not the same Rob Dibble the Cubs have seen three times in these two series.
Three balls and a strike. Ball four. And so runners are on at first and second, nobody out. And here's Sean Dunston.
Scott Breeden on the phone calling up the bullpen. And let's see who gets loose. Probably going to be John Franco.
The Cubs average for every single game scheduled here this year is over the 30,000 mark. Here's a ballpark. Seats less than 37,000, I think it is. And your average over 30,000 per game. Ground ball. Richardson has it. Double play. Boy, oh boy. Richardson looks like he belongs in the Hall of Fame. He's played a great shortstop himself. And he turned Dunston's ground ball into a double play.
Nobody turns it better at second base than Ron Oster. Watch this pivot. He gets rid of the ball quickly. And they double a tough man in Sean Dunston.
Here now is McClendon. Coming out as the pinch hitter. A runner at third, two men are out.
Lloyd hitting 290, 3 for 10 with a home run and an RBI as a pinch hitter. And John Franco warming up in the pen.
Inside, almost hit him. One ball, no strikes. Two men are out, a runner at third. 5-2 in favor of the Reds. Boy, this series started. Remember, Cubs were leading 5-1, and the Reds came back and beat them. There's a high pop fly. That'll be easy. Benzinger getting under the ball, and he makes the catch to retire the side. One hit, one left at the end of eight. 5-2, Cincinnati. Harry Carey back at the ballpark. We're going into the ninth. Mitch Williams is going to be the new pitcher for the Cubs. Kurt Wilkerson is playing shortstop. Lloyd McClendon is now catching.
Mitch Williams on the mound. 2-2, 171 ERA, on for the 61st time.
And now McClendon, the chest protector doesn't fit him right. He gets another one. 5-2, the Reds are leading. The Mets got beat, but unfortunately, the Cubs are in the process. They have one more chance to pull this game out.
They're going to have to do it against one of the premier left-handers in the league, John Franco, who continues to loosen in the bullpen. And Franco will come into this one looking for save number 27.
There's Williams' first pitch. Scott Scudder, 21-year-old left right-hander, is a pitcher of record.
Lloyd getting a look behind the plate, and he's got the toughest man on the club to catch in Mitch Williams.
Two balls and a strike. Swung and he missed. Two balls, two strikes, 5-2 in favor of the Reds. Rooms fouls it back. Rooms has played a big role. After striking out his first two times, he beat out a bump with one on and with a one out in the fifth, and scored with Joe Oliver homer to put the Reds ahead. He struck him out. Rooms goes down swinging. And that's the 11th strikeout again for the Cub pitchers today. They struck out 11 Reds in losing 7-2 yesterday, and have struck out 11 in losing 5-2 so far today. There's a high pop fly way back. The ball drops out there away from Dawson. Had a little trouble with the wind. Joe Oliver winds up with a double.
Third double of the year, and Andre Dawson is having a tough day in right field. He's playing him shallow, and Oliver, with good power, takes the ball into right. Now Andre once again starts coasting, and he just can't get to it.
Ball went right through his glove, it seemed like.
Looked like it tipped off the glove and bounced away from it.
One out, one on. Oster, who's a switch hitter, turning around to bat right-handed. Wilkerson playing short. Fastball low and inside. Funny thing, the misadventures have happened to the Cubs, who are more used to their home field than the visiting team. The Reds, I don't know whether it's because they haven't had any really tough chances, but they've not had any trouble at all. 1-1 pitch. Oster with one hit today, 1 out of 4. That evens it up 2-2. Well, Houston plays at Pittsburgh tonight, St. Louis at Atlanta, Los Angeles and Montreal, and San Diego at Philadelphia. There's a high pop foul, will go out of play. The only other game scheduled this afternoon was at New York at Chase Stadium, where San Francisco shut out the Mets 5-0. Two pitch. Fouled it again. 2-2.
Don Zimmer just wanting to give Mitch Williams an inning of work, trying to keep his control sharp, Even in a non-safe situation, you have to put your stopper in a ball game like this every now and then. Make sure he gets to the mound, so when you bring him in that tough situation, he feels comfortable.
There's a line drive, right field. Here's a runner trying to score. Now they stop him to throw to the plate. Grace tried to cut it off and roll away from him. But nevertheless, the runners are at first and third with one out as Oster lined a single to right.
The Reds looking like a championship ball club despite the fact that they're well up the track, hitting the ball all over the lot against everybody that Don Zimmer brings in from that bullpen.
The infield playing back. Here's Jeff Richardson, the shortstop. Strike call. Well, the teams that could gain ground tonight are Montreal and St. Louis. A wild pitch gets away from McClendon. Throws to the plate too late. It bounces away. Nobody can locate the ball. The other runner, Oster, goes all the way to third.
Things are just falling apart for the Cubs as they're doing just about everything wrong. The fifth wild pitch of the year, and when the ball gets away, it goes as an error on Lloyd McClendon, so he's going to pick up his fourth error of the year. No chance for McClendon to get that. Then he makes a throw. Throw gets away. No chance to get Oliver. And Oster moves into third.
You know what? I don't think he realized he had a chance to get the man at the plate. He kind of held the ball for a moment. A line drive for Richardson. Another run is in. Richardson singles the center. And the Cincinnati boosters who are here find reason to cheer. And they're chanting sweep. That's what Cub fans did in Cincinnati last week.
Fourth RBI of the year for Richardson.
Is Joel Youngblood coming out to hit for Dibble, for Rob Dibble.
Youngblood, who hit the pinch home run the other night, hitting 238, 8 for 30, with the one home run and three RBIs as a pinch hitter.
Now the ball, what happened there?
Hit him.
Hit him. So Youngblood reaches first. Richardson advances to second. Two runs are in.
Sweeping slider gets him right on the foot.
Here's Winningham with three hits, three out of four. One ball, no strikes. There's a strike call. Well, it's 7-2 again today as it was yesterday. There's a high fly ball. Jerome Walton coming in after first starting out. There's two out.
John Franco now in a non-save situation as he'll come in the ball game and just get an appearance for this one.
Two runs in, two on, and two out. Quiñones has three hits, three out of five. Turning around to hit right-handed against Mitch Williams. A high pop foul back and out of play. One ball, one strike. The Cubs will have lost their six in a row, right?
That'll be it.
The longest losing streak this year was seven in a row. It's also the longest winning streak, seven in a row. Two balls and a strike, two out, two on.
Ironic, because everybody looked at this side of the schedule and said it was favorable because you're not playing the West Coast teams the second half. But Houston swept the Cubs and Cincinnati on the verge of it.
Foul outside third base. It's really funny. Three teams each have 57 defeats. The Cubs will be the other team with 56. Woo, inside. Montreal and the Mets are now tied for second. Each a game and a half out. The Cardinals are fourth, two and a half back. Ball four. And the bases are loaded for Eric Davis, who was fanned one time. He's one out of five.
Not much Zim can do except take a look at this. Come back and try to get him again tomorrow unless they rally big in the ninth inning. Mike Bielecki keeping the chart, and he'll try to stem the tide.
Fastball low, ball one. Atlanta will be here Friday afternoon. Woo, almost a wild pitch.
Good stop by a man that hasn't done a whole lot of catching in Lloyd McClendon.
Two balls, no strikes. Bases loaded, two runs in. Wild pitch gets away, ball three, a run scores. The other runners advance.
What an inning this has been. Second wild pitch of the inning. Trying desperately to throw a strike, and this one misses the plate by about 3 feet.
Three balls, no strikes. Eric Davis takes a strike call. 8-2 now in favor of the Reds. He walked him. The bases are loaded again. And here is Bensinger. Two walks, a hit batsman, a strikeout, and three hits in the inning. Couple of wild pitches. Well, get it out of your system, boys. Get a good day off tomorrow and come roaring back Friday.
Dean Wilkins throwing in the bullpen.
Bensinger fouls it back. Bensinger is one out of four. Hitting right-handed for the first time today. Switch hitter. He fouls it off. 0-2 the count. And McClendon wants to talk to Mitch Williams. The Cubs got two in the first. A great stop by shortstop Jeff Richardson prevented the Cubs from scoring more. That ended the inning. And from then on, they didn't get another hit until the seventh. So who knows? Had Richardson not made the great stop, which was an infield hit, but it kept two runs from scoring, what the story might have been.
Might be 8-4 now.
Yeah. 0-2. Fouls it out of play. And they say the Cincinnati lineup is, they're playing with a crippled lineup. A lot of guys playing them wouldn't ordinarily be in the game. Quiñones, Richardson,
Winningham and Rooms, and Oliver.
He struck him out. Well, three runs scored on three hits, one error, three men left. We go to the bottom of the ninth. The Reds are leading 8-2. Harry Carey and Steve Stone, as we go into the bottom of the ninth, McLendon will lead it off, or rather Kurt Wilkerson.
Reds have left 14 with 17 hits, and John Franco in the ballgame, appearance number 46.
Franco was all prepared to pick up his 27th save, but the Reds, by scoring three more, make it a no-save situation. There's Wilkerson singling the right. Wilkerson batting right-handed against Franco, single to right. Here's Walton. The Reds, I would imagine, will entertain thoughts about trading Franco next year. Here's Walton. He is one out of two. Started the game with a walk. Back when life seemed so beautiful, when the Reds took an early first inning 2-0 lead. Ball two. Two balls, no strikes. 8-2 in favor of the Reds. Ball three. 3-0. There's a fastball. The wind's still blowing. It was reported that 18 miles an hour out of the north. When the game started, and I imagine it's about the same. 3-1. Walked to ball four. That's a third time today that Walton has walked. He's been on base four times. He's certainly filling the role of leadoff man out to perfection.
Walton had only walked 20 times coming into this game, so he's shown a lot of patience. And the Cubs trying to make things difficult for John Franco despite the six-run deficit.
There's Sandberg. One out of three. Scored a run. Good pickup by Joe Oliver. One ball, no strikes. Oliver, 24-year-old rookie, a fine-looking ball player.
Four hits today for Joe Oliver.
There's a strike call, 1-1. He fouls it off. Oliver out of Memphis, Tennessee. Signed with the Reds in 1983. Into the dirt. Another nice stop.
Jackson hitting .231 this year. 1-for-10 with an RBI as a pinch hitter.
He's hitting for Dwight Smith, who is 0-for-4. Darren Jackson takes the first pitch of strike call. 8-2 in favor of the Reds. Nice save by Joe Oliver. Outside.
Franco, originally a product of the Los Angeles Dodger organization, was traded as a minor leaguer to Cincinnati.
He swings and he misses. 2-2 the count. Darren Jackson batting for Dwight Smith. Runners first and third. One away. Bottom of the ninth. Struck him out on a slow curve. Fooled him completely. There's Mark Grace. He's one out of four. One run batted in. This should be the ball game. Richardson coming in. Hey, he might beat it out. Safe. A run score. Richardson throw. First, he fielded a running and had a little trouble getting the ball ready to throw it. It's an error. Who's going to err on the throw, I guess?
They charge the error to Richardson, his second of the year. It looked like the game was over, but Richardson bobbles the ball, makes a wide throw, and the Cubs get another run.
So Wilkerson crossed the plate, and here's Andre Dawson. 8-3 now. Dawson's had one hit, walked twice, one out of two. There's a base hit in the right center. A run's gonna score. Another man going to third. Mark Grace advances to third as Dawson drives in his 52nd run of the year. 8-4.
Cubs keep it alive, and one more base runner, and the tying run will come to bat. It's all in the hands of Vance Law as Andre Dawson picks up his second hit of the day to go along with a couple of walks.
Vance Law is one out of three. 8-4 now. Well, the Cubs have started well today and they're finishing well, but let's see how it ends up. Ball two.
Domingo Ramos in the on-deck circle. He'll come on to pinch hit for Mitch Williams.
Two balls, no strikes. Trying to check his swing, fouled a pitch back. If it gets to Ramos, he'll represent the tying run. 8-4 in favor of the Reds, two men are on. And Vance Law has accounted two balls and a strike. There's a drive in the right field. There's a base hit going to the wall. One run in. Here's another runner who's going to be held up at third. Dawson had to be held at third, and Ramos, who would be the hitter representing the tying run.
39th RBI and the 21st double of the year for Vance Law. He slices this ball away from Rolando Rooms, and things starting to get interesting here in Chicago.
And here comes Scott Breedman to talk to Franco. Boy, oh boy, you wonder whether the same thing had happened if you'd held them in the top of the ninth when they padded their lead. They huddle around the mound. It's 8-5 Cincinnati with Ramos, the hitter. The wind blowing in at 18 miles an hour.
Norm Charlton throwing in the bullpen.
Ramos hitting 273, one homer, 16 RBI. He's been very successful as a pinch hitter. 5 out of 10. Franco Spitz swung and a line drive foul. 0-1 the count.
Nobody up in the bullpen for the Cubs, but if Ramos does get a base hit, Zim will have to get somebody loose.
Almost threw it away. Another fine stop by Joe Oliver, who's been outstanding back there, besides his four hits. And the homer to put him ahead originally. 3-2 in the fifth. One ball, one strike. Held up, ball two. Two balls and a strike. Lloyd McClendon would be next. He had a cut. 2-2. Steve Wilson working in the bullpen for the Cubs. Two balls, two strikes. Come out. The game is over. And the Reds have swept the Chicago Cubs, beating them 8-5 this afternoon. 7-2 yesterday. 6-5 the first night game. We'll be back with the totals in a moment. The Budweiser play of the game. This might show you what's been going on this week. A high drive in the right field. Andre Dawson goes back, bumps his head. The ball is on his back for a moment. He is not partially unconscious. The ball lies there, and Scudder, the pitcher, scores all the way from first base. That's the only possible way he could have scored. That is the Budweiser play of the game, which I think shows you the kind of a week it's been.
No doubt, Harry. Everything that could go wrong the last six games for the Cubs has gone wrong. The pitching just hasn't been there. The team ERA now hovering around the 3-4 mark. This was the team ERA that was hovering just over 3 for a long time. Nobody's been able to do the job. Mitch Williams had a tough ninth inning, and you didn't think much about it until you scored 3 in the ninth and made some noise. So the Cubs not doing things well at this particular point, and Andre did have a tough day in right field.
Well, you know, there's no way of knowing whether the Cubs would have scored 3 runs had they not scored them. Maybe Franco would have been a little bearing down a little more. He knew that he couldn't get a save and that he's just going to finish up the game. But be that as it may, I'm just wondering whether there is something to this stuff you always read about 69 and what happened before. The fact that the Cubs have never been in the World Series since the year I started broadcasting in 1945. I wonder if there's something to it. It could be.
I don't think there's anything to this team, Harry, because most of these guys weren't around in 1969, certainly weren't around in 1945. It's just a case of a ball club having all the breaks going for them, in the case of the Cubs, suddenly go through a period of adversity. And now we'll see what the team is made of, because the team still has 6 games at home. It still has a lead. And they have their own destiny in their own hands. And that's something you always want to have as you head into September. So right now, you're looking at the possible trades. I know Jim Frey is spending a lot of time on the phone. Let's see what happens.
You know, you think back again to the first inning. We were a little facetious about it before. But if that ground ball gets through it the way it looked it was going to, 2 more runs would have scored. The Cubs would be leading 4-0, still batting in the first inning. As the way that things happen, it might have been a different story.
Well, due to injuries, the Reds were forced to bring up a 21-year-old youngster named Scott Scudder. He got off to a rocky start today, but then didn't give the Cubs another hit through the next 5 innings. Cubs had all their offense against him in the first inning, and you have to credit him because he did a pretty good job. And when you look at some of the arms that these organizations bring to the major leagues, you see a lot of good fastballs. Scudder certainly fills that bill, Harry. He threw the ball 90 miles an hour today. He didn't get the breaking ball over the plate, but he has a good straight change. And the Reds did exactly what they had to do in this series. They had timely defense. 17 hits today. They left 14 men on base. The Reds were all over the bases. The Cubs just couldn't get them out.
I tell you something, they showed me three good young ball players. The kid at shortstop, I don't know how he's going to fare, but in Cincinnati as well as here, he played a great game at shortstop and pitched in a couple of hits. Scudder, I think, has, for only 21 years old, he's got a lot of poise and he's got a great arm. And the other boy, Joe Oliver, behind the plate, I can't recall. I know that we have a fine young catcher, and Damon Berryhill, and I certainly wish he were able to play, but he's been a little hurt. And we're very high on Berryhill, but this Oliver really caught beautifully and hit with authority. As a matter of fact, his home run put him ahead 3-2, and I didn't think anybody could hit a home run today.
There were a lot of catchers in the Cincinnati organization that had to find other positions because of Johnny Bench for many years. I think Jeff Richardson's in the same situation. He's got Barry Larkin as the incumbent. Larkin was hitting 340 when he went down with the elbow problem. He is the shortstop of the future, one of the best players in the league. So Richardson, although he looks pretty good at this point, I don't think he's going to find that spot open at shortstop for him.
All right, I wonder what those standings look like now, Arnie. There they are. Look at the lost side. Only one game's difference between the Cubs and three other teams. 57 defeats by New York, Montreal, and St. Louis. 56 by the Cubs. So the Cubs hold a game and a half lead over the New York Mets. But the Mets now are tied for second with Montreal, and those Cardinals are getting dangerously close.
Everybody knew it would be a four-team race as soon as the Cubs started putting some good baseball together. And Harry, your old mates in St. Louis making things interesting. They're winning most every day. The Cubs on this prolonged losing streak. And it's going to be very interesting because the Cubs, after this swing through the rest, will be done with all the Western teams. All they'll have left then are the people that they have to beat. They still have six big ones left at home.
You know, one thing about the Cardinals, nobody's been paying too much attention to them. That might have been working to their advantage. Whereas all the attention's been focused on the Cubs, media-wise, the Mets, and Montreal. Maybe now that they're in the running, maybe some of the attention will be directed at them and will be concentrating on them too, and maybe they'll run into a slump like we have.
Well, they've got to go on the road sometime, and so far they're doing everything right. They've also got a pretty good man who's piloting the ship in Whitey Herzog, and Whitey seems to get the best out of the bullpen, Harry. When you look around, everybody says the Cardinals don't have enough pitching, and then you suddenly look at the standings and you realize that whatever pitching they do have, put a little speed and some hitters into that lineup, and suddenly the ball club is right there.
And they went, how in the world did they get that Ted Powers, who never has impressed anybody that much? But all of a sudden, for Whitey Herzog, he's been a starter, and he's been a good starter.
Every team has made some moves. Every team in contention has made the moves to this point. You look at New York, they got Viola. You look at Montreal, they got Langston. And St. Louis has made a couple of deals. Perhaps this is time that Jim Frey will have to do what he can do to add something to this ball club. I know he's trying because he's spending a lot of time on the phone. The bills are mounting up. So far, nothing much happening.
Yeah, but not to the point, I think, of panic, because this is a young team, Steve. These guys are learning through this experience of going through a little losing streak at the before you go into September. A lot of time to rebound from this. I'd hate to see them trade some of the good guys, young guys, that we have who've been playing well. No ball player is as good as he is, as he looks when he's going great. And he's not as bad as he looks when things are going bad. Somewhere his real value is in between. And we got a lot of young talent that I think is very outstanding for the future ahead. And even if the Cubs didn't win it this year, I'd like to feel that this young nucleus would be here next year.
Jim Frey has echoed your sentiments, Harry. He said time and time again, he is not going to break up this ball club that he thinks is going to bode well in the future. He's going to stay with what he's got, try to pick up a fringe player or two. And, Harry, better luck on Friday.
See you then. Spend the good day off,
will you?
All right, here are the totals now. for the victorious Cincinnati Reds. 8 runs, 17 hits, 1 error. Scott Scudder is the winner. He now has 1-3 and lost 5. For the Cubs, 5 runs, 9 hits, 2 errors. Greg Maddux, the loser, he has won 14 now and lost 10. Well, tomorrow's a day off. We'll see you Friday afternoon. With Dwayne Statz and Steve Stone, this is Harry Carey from Wrigley Field, where the Reds swept the Cubs, beating them today by the score of 8-5. So long, everybody.